My name is Tika and I'm the communications director here at City Life.
And welcome everyone, I'm Daryl, I'm the student ministry director.
Tika, what has been your favorite part about City Life Online?
Probably that I get to wear PJs to church.
Seriously?
Okay. Probably meeting people that I never would have met if we weren't gathering online. If this is your first time joining us today, hey, we would love to get to know you. There's a link popping up that you can click so we can connect with you. Now, what about you, Dee? What's been your favorite thing about City Life Online?
Probably that I get to wear my PJs.
Seriously?
Yep. But also being with my family, spending more time.
I love your family. Did you know that we're having a back to school supplies giveaway next weekend?
Yes. Hey guys, Saturday, August 15th from 10 a.m. to noon, we will have a school supplies drive-through. We'll provide you with all the needs for back to school at home with your kids. I'm talking headphones, snacks, personal whiteboards, and much more. So please come on by.
That is awesome. I love that we can do that for everyone. Hey Dee, are you ready for worship?
Absolutely. City Life, let's get up on your feet and get prepared for our hearts in this time of prayer and worship.
What is up, City Life? We're excited to worship with you. We want to invite you to just stand, clap along, sing along as we worship Jesus. I give you glory.
I give you glory for all you've brought me through. And now I'm ready
exalt your name today, right here, right now, because you are worthy. Exalt the name of Jesus. That simply means we're going to lift it up higher than our situation, higher than our circumstances, higher than anything that's happening around us. We're going to lift up the name of Jesus. We're going to worship him above all else. Because you're worthy, you're worthy. Oh, you're worthy, Jesus. And be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You belong. Serve our praise. You're the name above all names, and be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names, and be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. name like your name, Jesus. We worship you. We praise you. We pray that you would fill every home, every space right now where your name is being lifted. May your spirit come and reside among us today, Jesus. We love you. We praise you because you alone are worthy. Amen.
What's up, everybody? What a privilege it is to welcome you this weekend to City Life Online. Right now, we are one church that's gathering in so many locations all over our city and all over the country and even from around the world. People are a part of our church community in this season, and it's exciting because the church is not a building. We are the people of God, and so wherever and however we gather, God is with us. And he's moving. And so I'm believing that he's impacting your life even right now. Hey, we're in this series we're calling How to Be Happy. And really the big idea of this series is that happiness is not found by you and I arriving at some mysterious place in life. That happiness is about you and I becoming a particular kind of person. That really it's an inside job that God wants to do within our hearts. That happiness is less about our circumstances externally and a lot more about our character and what's going on the inside of us. And so we can spend so much time trying to adjust and change our external circumstances, but God wants to do a work deep within your heart that will actually produce a deep sense of blessing and happiness in your life. And so we're studying Jesus' most famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount, that is found in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. It's three chapters long, but in particular, we're looking at these initial eight statements that Jesus makes at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount called the Beatitudes, where Jesus is describing for us attitudes that we can adopt as followers of Jesus that God begins to produce by grace inside of us that really set us apart and lead us into the hashtag blessed life, into real happiness and blessing. And so Jesus is going to speak to us today. We're looking at the seventh beatitude in verse 9 of Matthew chapter 5 about our relationships. About our relationships. And I think it is so right on time for me, and I think for many of us in this season, because I don't know if there's anything that can produce more stress in our lives than our relationships. I mean, when you think about everything that produces stress in your life, money and job changes, and some of you are experiencing that right now, job losses, income changes, all of these things, going to a new school, maybe you're a college student trying to figure out what school even going to look like in this fall semester, thinking about, as a parent, kids in online school, illnesses, all of these things that can produce stress in our lives. Maybe what produces more stress than anything else, it's when you begin to recognize there's tension, there's distance, there is division in a relationship in your life. That can just affect everything else, right? I mean, when you begin to experience tension, maybe it's a relationship with a friend or within your family, or maybe it's a spouse in your marriage, and it's just some distance that's growing there. Or maybe it's you know, in your blended family, that it's with an ex-husband or an ex-wife, or maybe it's with your children, you know, small children, teenage children, grown children. At any age, we can experience stress in a relationship. Maybe it's a team that you manage at work and there's some disunity, or maybe just another coworker. But when we begin to experience tension in our relationships, it can affect the way we work. It can affect our physical health. It can affect our emotional health. It can affect so many areas of our lives. And so Jesus is going to speak to us this weekend. And here's what I believe. I want you to just open up your heart right now, because as I was praying for your relationships and getting ready for this message, I really felt like God was offering three things this weekend. He's offering to you hope and health and healing for your relationships. Some of you need a fresh dose of hope in a relationship right now. Maybe you're looking at a relationship in your life that is just, it seems like it's dead. Or maybe it's so broke, you don't know if it could ever be fixed. And maybe it's a relationship that you know is not leaving your life anytime soon. Maybe it's the parent of your child, the other parent. Or maybe it's a spouse or your own parent, and you can't get another parent. You don't want to get another spouse most days. And I just have good news for you, that our God who raises dead things back to life can bring new life, I believe, even to the most broken relationships in our lives. There's hope. There's hope. And then some of you just need some health. You need a relationship to grow and to get past some things. Or some of you need some healing in a relationship. You need, in your own heart, healing so that you can become the emotionally healthy person that can enter into healthy relationships yourself. Hope, health, healing. God is holding it out to us in our relationships. And so let's look at this seventh beatitude in Matthew 5, verse 9. So encouraging, so practical. Here's what Jesus says. Blessed are the peacemakers, there's our key word, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed, happy are the peacemakers. Now I'm telling you, this is countercultural. Because what Jesus is saying here is that if you want to experience supreme happiness, blessing in your life, then be a peacemaker. Be the kind of person that when you recognize tension in a relationship, you don't walk away from it, you don't try to avoid it, but instead you walk right into it in order to make and create and initiate peace. And it's countercultural, because most of us, you know, probably would not put those things together, that if I want to be happier, you know, I need to enter into tension. I think a lot of us, I mean, I'll speak for myself, I want to get as far away from tension and difficult conversations as I can. But Jesus is saying, no. The truly happy person, the blessed person, is the person who is able to step into tension and not just say, I'm going to hope for peace or wait for somebody else to take the step to make peace, but I am going to be a peacemaker through the strength of God. And so here's what I want to do. I want to take just a little online poll right now, okay? And so I need a little group participation. Wherever you're watching this, wherever you are, I need you just go ahead and get your typing fingers ready, okay? Get them up, shake them out, get your typing fingers ready. And I'm going to ask you a couple questions, and I want you just to, if you resonate with the question, just type into the chat box right there where you are, that's me. That's all you got to do. Type, that's me, two words, if you resonate, okay? Question number one, everybody play along. How many of you want to be happy in your life? Go ahead, if that's you, just right there in the chat box. That's me. Yep, that's me too. That's me too. I want to be happy, okay? I'll give you a second. Go ahead, play along. That's me. All right, question number two. How many of you want to experience more peace in your life? How many of you want to experience more peace in your relationships? Go ahead, get your fingers ready. That's me. If that's you, come on, that's me too. I want to experience all the peace that God has for my relationships. Okay, question number three. How many of you just love conversations that are difficult and awkward and tense? Anybody? Anybody? I think we all know somebody, you know, who maybe is typing that's me into the box right now. They're called psychos. Listen, if that's you, We're thrilled that you're here. I'm especially glad that you're with us online. Because even, you know, if you're somebody who maybe you're getting better at handling conflict, or maybe you are becoming more comfortable engaging in tension, I don't think anybody wakes up in the morning and thinks, you know what would be awesome is that if today I could just have some really difficult conversations, that would be amazing. No, I think most of us do everything we can to avoid difficult conversations. Yet what Jesus is going to say is that the pathway to blessing and happiness in our lives is to enter into the tension and make peace. And so here's what I want to do. I want to define what peacemaking is. But first, let me just clarify what we're not talking about. Number one, peacemaking is not appeasement. Peacemaking is not just letting everybody roll all over you. Peacemaking is not just giving in when it comes to every issue. There are some things that you need to stand up for in life. In fact, appeasement does not produce peace. It produces the opposite. It produces resentment in relationships, because what's going to happen in a relationship if you constantly let somebody just steamroll over your values is that you're going to end up feeling like somebody who has been discounted and used, not the blessing and the happiness that God has for us and the peace that he wants in your relationship. So peacemaking is not appeasement, and peacemaking, number two, is not avoidance. There were important issues that Jesus entered into that he didn't ignore. And in our lives, there are important things that we need to stand up for and not avoid and not ignore. And so I think it's not for the sake of peace that you avoid important issues. In fact, I'll just tell you that if you become somebody who is avoiding conflict, you won't be a peacemaker. You're going to be a troublemaker. Because for a lot of us, what we end up doing is we just think, man, just sweep it under the rug. Sweep it under the rug, sweep it under the rug. And what happens if you keep sweeping it under the rug is you wind up with a big mound on that rug. And eventually somebody's going to come walking by and they're going to trip over that rug and they are going to hurt themselves and maybe hurt some other people. And that's what happens in our relationships when we just avoid tension. And so that's not what we're talking about. Peacemaking is so practical and so powerful. And so I want to give you this definition. Go ahead and get this down, because come on, we're going to get some encouragement for our relationships. And so here's what peacemakers do. Peacemakers are courageous leaders. They're willing to go first. They're leaders who are willing, look at this, to become uncomfortable enough to, and here's our key word, initiate reconciliation in a relationship. That's who peacemakers are. Courageous leaders who are willing to say, I'll become uncomfortable and I'll get a little awkward and let things get a little tense so that I can initiate something here, and that's reconciliation in a relationship. Say, well, wait a second, Brad. You just don't understand. You don't get it. It's not my fault. They started it. If anything, they should be the one who sends the text. They should be the one to start the conversation. I'm waiting on them to initiate peace here. They're the ones who started it. And so let me just ask you, because a lot of us do this, and I've done this before. How's it working for you? How's it working for you? Because while we can wait weeks and sometimes months and sometimes even years for somebody else to take the first step, it's not just their happiness and health that's suffering. We're allowing them to hold our own health and happiness hostage because we're unwilling to go first. And so if you've ever been in a stalemate in some relationship, you know this can happen. That you're in a stalemate and you're both waiting and nobody's willing to go first. And it takes somebody who says, I believe that God wants peace and I want peace and I love God and I love you. And so I'm willing to be the leader who's courageous and get uncomfortable and initiate peace. That's what we're talking about. It's an active thing. Blessed are the peacemakers. And I'll tell you what, this is hard. This is hard. But here's the good news. Life gives us all kinds of opportunities to practice. Leah and I, about a month or two ago, we were not doing well. We were struggling. And I know, you know, I'm a pastor. I'm supposed to have a perfect marriage. I keep trying to tell Leah that. But to be fair to her, it's not easy being married to a perfect person, right? And so we were just not clicking. And there's so much in this season. You know, our lives had changed so radically. Her schedule's changed. My schedule's changed. Our kids' schedules have changed. Trying to be homeschool parents. And then somebody had the bright idea to bring a six-week-old puppy into our home. And we're trying to get him to go to the bathroom. And Leah and I just became like ships passing in the night. We weren't communicating. We weren't talking. We weren't clicking. Most nights, you know, I was going to bed first, and by the time she got up, I was already asleep. And what happens when that kind of distance starts to come and there's not communication is that resentment starts to fill that gap of silence. And all of a sudden, I'm assuming the worst about her, and she's assuming the worst about me, and I'm feeling like she just doesn't understand my needs, and she's feeling like I don't understand her needs. And we came to a place where we just weren't okay. And so finally, we had to just sit down and recognize and confess and admit we're not okay, and even more importantly, we're not okay not being okay. And it was weird, and it was awkward, and it was difficult, even after 12 years of marriage. But we had to put our hands together and just simply pray to break the ice. And ask God, help us. And, you know, I don't even think I was looking at her when we were praying. It was just, God, we're not okay. Come and help us figure this out. And after prayer, you know, we stayed up late talking, beginning to communicate again, beginning to understand each other again. But that's where it starts, by being willing to break the tension and enter in, even as it's uncomfortable, to be a peacemaker in your relationship. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. That's our calling. So how in the world do we put this into practice? Because this isn't normal in our world. And so how do we put this into practice? Fortunately, Jesus, in the very same Sermon on the Mount, sitting on the same mountain talking to the same crowd, just a few verses later in chapter 5, gives such a practical application of this beatitude. And so I want to skip down just a few verses to verse 23 of Matthew chapter 5 to see this radical practical application of peacemaking. And here it is, verse 23. So, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, before you finish worshiping, before you click that donate button to give your tithe and worship to God, before you take your hands out of your pocket to even lift them into the air to worship and sing, before any of that, first, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. This is so radical. Jesus says, if you're getting ready to worship, and all of a sudden you're getting ready to worship, Harold pops into your head. Oh, Harold, Harold. And you're thinking, man, I'm just going to power worship through this. Jesus is saying, no, pause. Before you give, before you sing, before you take another step, here's how important peacemaking is. Get things right with Harold, and then you can continue on. And I'm telling you, this is so unusual in our world, and this is so radical that I want to just step into this for a moment and try to understand practically what does this look like and to go deep into this with Jesus. And so let me just give you three thoughts here from this example Jesus gives us here in Matthew chapter 5. And first, I want you to notice the connection between our relationship to God and our relationship with the people who are around us. There is a connection. You can't separate them. If you're going to love and worship a God that you can't see, then you've got to be able to love and walk in peace with the people that you can see, that you work with, that you live with, that you worship with, that you small group with, that you play with. Jesus is going to say, you can't separate the two. You know, I think a lot of us, we want to say, you know, just, man, just give me Jesus. Just give me Jesus. All I need is Jesus. me and quarantine are doing great. Quarantine can go on forever because me and Jesus are good. I don't really need people. Who cares about Harold? And what Jesus will say is, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. You can't say, just give me Jesus and forget about Harold. That it's a, there's a connection that is there between them. I want to read this to you because, again, here's what Jesus is saying. You can't hold a grudge and worship God at the same time. So watch this. I think this is so powerful. Colossians 1, verse 19. For God, in all his fullness, was pleased to live in Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. God's the ultimate peacemaker, the ultimate reconciler. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you who are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. And then notice here how he ends this. But you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. In other words, here's what Paul's writing in Colossians, that nobody has ever been more distanced from someone else than you and I were from God. Yet God became the supreme peacemaker who was willing to be that courageous leader to go first. And God was willing to get the ultimate uncomfortable on the cross, to lay down his own life, to enter into the tension of our sin and to bring us back into relationship with himself, to accomplish reconciliation between us and between God. That is, my friend, a gift. That's the greatest miracle that has ever taken place. And when it is activated on the inside of you, it brings you into a friendship and a relationship with God Almighty personally himself. But what happens if you are not interested in extending that same peace to others, and if you're not willing to get up on your own cross and to sacrifice your own pride in order to become uncomfortable, perhaps in a conversation, is that ultimately you will deactivate the benefits of the gospel in your own heart. You can't separate them, but when we are willing to let go of the grudge and to get rid of the hate and to put grace on the wound, all of a sudden the blood of Jesus covers the bad blood in your relationships, and you can experience all of the grace and the freedom that God has for you. And for some of you, the reason that your relationship with God feels like it's at a stalemate is because you have another relationship in your life that is not at peace, and you've been unwilling to enter into the discomfort toward reconciliation. There's a connection. I want you to notice, second, the command. And here's the command. It's so radical. He says, put down your gift right there at the altar. And what does he say? Go. Go. Take a step. Take an action step and go. Now, here's the context for this. In that day, this is happening. Jesus is telling a story. This is happening at the temple. And what would happen is that four or five times a year, a faithful Jew would travel from their home and they would go to the temple, where they would either bring a sacrifice with them or they would buy one at the temple, maybe a pigeon, maybe a lamb, and they would come and they would wait in line and they would stand before the priest. Finally, it would be their turn and they would offer the gift, they would offer the sacrifice. And so here is, you know, somebody who's made the trip, and they've got their four kids, and they've walked 5 hours to get to Jerusalem, and they bought the pigeon, and they waited in line, and they got up to the priest, and it's finally their turn to offer the sacrifice, and all of a sudden, there they are, Harold. Harold pops into their mind. And what Jesus says is, put down the pigeon, you know, put it in the locker at the entrance to the temple, or carry it home with you, and you're going to walk 5 hours back to Galilee, back to Capernaum with your four kids. You're going to go get the stickers and check them out of the kids' wing of the temple and go all the way back home. And you're going to, what? Look up Harold. And you're going to talk to the last person in the world that you want to be talking to so that you can then turn around and walk 5 hours back to the temple and get back in line. And hopefully your pigeon's still alive and hasn't pooped all over your kids during the 5 hour walk back to the temple and get back to the priest so you can offer your sacrifice finally there, having been reconciled to Harold. That's what Jesus is calling us to do, and it is so radical and it is so healthy. But could you imagine if we all took this command literally? I mean, right now we would need to shut down YouTube, shut down Facebook. Everybody would probably have to log off of the City Life website. And, you know, that little number right now that's in the screen is just going to start counting down until there's one or two of us left in this video room who have perfect relationships in our lives. But where's everybody else is out on FaceTime with Harold. And they're out there. I mean, if we do this, we would have to have like an intermission in every church service, like 30-minute break after worship. Okay, we're going to take 30 minutes. Everybody go line up and talk to Harold, poor Harold. If your name is Harold, I don't know if God's speaking to you through this message. My apologies. But that's what's happening. I mean, this is a radical command. And so how do we put this into practice? I want to just end hopefully and practically. And so let's look at number three, the goal. What's the goal of all of this? Let's look at it one more time. Matthew 5, 23 through 24. Here's what he says. Leave your gift there before the altar and go. Here's the goal. Here's the goal. Be reconciled. Reconciliation is the goal. You know what reconciliation is? It's to restore a relationship. Reconciliation. It's to make things right. It's to build a bridge. It's to repair the breach. That's reconciliation. To make things right. And so what does reconciliation look like? How do we experience it? This is such a special thing in our world and unusual. And so I want to just give you three important characteristics of reconciliation. Here's the first one so we can understand this. Reconciliation begins with and builds on forgiveness. Forgiveness is not the same thing as reconciliation, but forgiveness is often the first step toward reconciliation. But notice that forgiveness is not an end in itself. Forgiveness does something incredibly healthy and freeing inside of you, but forgiveness is supposed to lead somewhere, and that's to the rebirth of the relationship. It's powerful. Reconciliation, number two, has limits. This is really important. You can't achieve reconciliation by yourself. Listen, get this down. A relationship can only be as healthy as the unhealthiest person in the relationship. And that's the limit. That's the limit. Is that you can't control how someone else responds. You can't control what somebody else wants. You can't control the steps that somebody else might be willing to take. And so all you can control are your own choices and your own desires and your own actions and your own decisions. And so that's the limit that's there with reconciliation, which means that reconciliation is not a call for you to live in an abusive relationship. Reconciliation does not mean that you have to trust somebody who has proven themselves to be untrustworthy. Reconciliation does not mean that you have to give your heart to somebody that could abuse it, or that you have to risk your future or your dreams or some other relationship in your life to somebody that can't be trusted. And so for reconciliation to be possible, it often means there has to be a redefinition of the relationship. And so let me show you this in Scripture, Romans chapter 12. This letter from the Apostle Paul, I think, he gives us some practical advice for pursuing peace with others and then a principle that's so important. Let's read the list first. Romans 12, verse 9. Don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. These are all the things we can do. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. Don't think you know it all. Never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you are honorable. These are all the things we can do to love others, to carry others' burdens, to speak in a life-giving way to others and about others. But notice the principle in verse 18. Look at this. Here's what he says. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. You see it? Do all that you can. One translation says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everybody. That's all you can do, is what you can do. And so, here's my question for you. Do all that you can. That's the word of the Lord. Do all that you can. And so, my question is, you process this and apply this personally. What can you do? I want you to just, wherever you're watching this, think right now of the herald in your life. Whatever that source of relationship tension might be for you. And I want you to answer this question. What can you do? Maybe what you can do is send a text message today. Maybe what you can do is set up a coffee meeting and initiate a conversation. Maybe what you can do is apologize. You know, we have forgotten how to apologize to people in our world. We have to hire PR marketing firms to write our apologies for us. But maybe what you can do is to look somebody in the eye and face to face say, I'm sorry. I've blown it. Tell me what I can do to make things right. Please forgive me. What can you do? Maybe what you need to do is to reconcile yourself with God. Maybe that's the step you need to take. That before you can even hope to begin to be a peacemaker with others, you've got to enter into peace with God. Receive the gift of Christ by faith into your heart. Maybe what you need to do is take a step to become an emotionally healthy person. Because for some of you who are watching this, the truth is that if you were to try and go and have that conversation and pursue reconciliation, it wouldn't work. You would say some things that would make it worse. Because the anger, the bitterness, the insecurity, you aren't healthy enough to do this yet. And the best thing, if that's you, that you could do is to pause and recognize that's true and take a step to become a healthier person who can then live out health in your relationships. Listen, I get it. Some of you have been hurt and betrayed and abused by people in ways that I could never understand. And I want to say to you, my friend, if that's you, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry for what they said to you, for what they didn't say, for what they did, for what they didn't do. I'm so sorry they left and walked out when you needed them the most. If that's where you are, filled with anger, filled with bitterness, can I just encourage you? Your happiness is at stake. To take a step, to sit down with a counselor, to dig into some things from your past, to confront the trauma, to become a healthier person. What can you do? Do all that you can. Do all that you can. And then, here's the last thing I'll leave you with when it comes to reconciliation. Reconciliation requires a focus on obedience over outcomes. You do all that you can and you leave the results to God. And I think this is really what's so important, isn't it? Because what holds us back from initiating peace and from making peace is we want to know how it's all going to turn out. I'm not making that phone call unless I know that Harold's going to play ball. Right? I'm not sitting down for coffee and sending that text unless I know for sure I'm not going to get hurt again. And we want to know what the outcomes are going to be, and we want to predict the future, and the problem is we can't. And so what can you do? What are you responsible for? Obedience. Obey the commands of Jesus. Do what you can. And if you will, with a sincere heart, do what you can, then you can take a deep breath and rest in the confidence that God will do what you can't do. And all you can do is extend grace. It's up to God to produce healing. So, you're on the hook for obedience. Leave the outcomes to God. And what's the promise? One more time, we'll end where we started with this awesome beatitude. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called, what? Sons of God. You know, when God sees one of his own being willing to be a courageous leader and become uncomfortable and initiate peace, I believe he looks down from heaven and he says, that's my girl. That's my boy. That's somebody who's being transformed by grace. That's somebody who's letting the power of my spirit work through them. That's my kid. And that's what I want for you. Let's pray. God, I thank you so much that you came all the way from heaven to earth to make peace with us. And even when we were your enemies, even when we were sinning and rebelling against you, you reconciled us to yourself through the cross. And God, I pray that because of that, we would become peacemakers in our own lives and in our own relationships. In Jesus' name, amen. And my friend, I don't know where you are at spiritually this weekend, but I know this, God loves you, and God did everything that he could do and everything he needed to do to make reconciliation possible between you and him. And I want to extend to you an invitation. If you know that things are not right between you and God, but you're willing to take a step toward him right now and experience peace with God, that's where all of this starts, to experience peace with God. I'm going to pray a prayer, and I just want to invite you to pray this with me wherever you're watching this, in your home, in your car. Pray this with me out loud. Say, Jesus, I need your peace in my life. I'm tired of fighting with you. I'm tired of fighting with others. I'm ready for peace. I confess my sin. I believe you died for me. I believe you're alive. Forgive me. Change me from the inside out. Make me a peacemaker. Amen. Come on. Yes. If you prayed that prayer, this is the start of a new journey right now. And we have something very practical. It's just a link that's popping up in the chat wherever you're watching this. Can I encourage you, take one more step and click that link. Click that link and give us just the opportunity to connect with you and partner with you in this new faith journey that you're a part of right now. And here's what we're going to do. We are going to enter into one final song here together that just declares the faithfulness of God, which is, again, why any of this is possible. And as we begin to just thank God for his faithfulness, I believe he's giving us the power to be faithful for another week in our own relationships with one another. And so I want to invite you to just stand up from the couch, stand up from your chair, stand up wherever you're watching this, and can we just begin to worship for a few more moments? And I'm going to close with prayer, but let's just sing and let's just declare the faithfulness of God together. Come on, let's do it.
Desperate, thirsty souls,
thirsty for you, God.
City longing for real hope.
That's where we are, God, longing for more of you.
Every generation craves.
We need you, God.
Redemption from the one who saves.
Come on, church family.
You're the one who holds your children close.
He's holding you close right now. Let's thank him for it.
You're the one who never lets us go.
Trust him.
And we trust in the faithfulness of God. And your promise can't be broken.
That's the truth, my friend.
Though our hearts may need to mend.
Hope, health, healing.
We will trust in
that's
the
his promise.
Faithfulness of God. And it will never end. heart, we know you cannot lie.
It's so good to worship God. Lift your voice.
And to every generation,
you've kept your word, God.
Kept your word a thousand times.
And a thousand more times you'll keep
it. You're the one who holds your children close.
Thank you, God, for holding us close.
You're the one who never lets us go.
Thank you, God, that you've never let us go. That you hold on.
We trust in the faithfulness of God.
We trust you with our relationship.
And your promise can be broken.
Thank you for every single promise you've made to us.
Though our hearts may need to mend, we will trust in the faithfulness of God. And it will never end.
Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Come on, thank him wherever you're watching this. Thank him for his faithfulness. He's never going to let you go. His promises are firm. His promises are strong.
Savior, forgiver, defender.
That's who he is. Savior, forgiver, defender.
We cry out, holy, so loving and coming with mercy. You are great is your faithfulness.
Thank you right now that you are a faithful God who keeps your promises. You're a covenant-keeping God. And so we just rest in that, that you're a Savior, that you're a forgiver, that you're a defender. We trust in that. And I just pray right now a blessing over every person who's experiencing this service and over every person that they are in relationship with, that this week we would be peacemakers as you empower us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, thanks for logging in and tuning in and being a part of this service. I love you so much. We're going to hand it back over to our hosts. Have a great week.
Amen. God is so faithful. And if you made the next steps to follow Jesus, congrats. So take the time right now to click the link below so that we can provide you with the next steps and resources.
Yes, thank you, City Life family, for everything. Your generosity during this season has been overwhelming. If you want to give this week, you can via the City Life app, our website, snail mail, or use the link popping up now.
Nice. And we hope to see you at one of our prayer gatherings, either online Monday or in person Thursday, right here at City Life. And City Life Outdoors is continuing, so please register your spot through our website or through our app.
You can view all the details online. And remember, City Life Online is sticking around. So if you don't feel well, you don't live in the area, or you just can't make it, we'll see you right here online next week.
All right, guys, have a great week.